Booyah! What's pop locking, y'all? Big Cool Boy, the Body Puppets, West Coast Pop Lockers, down here at Cool Boys Boxing Camp and Dance Academy. And this is my YouTube channel where I allow pop lockers to come and express themselves. Talk about what happened, talk about how it went down, and talk about what you gonna do or what you did. You feel me? This is Cool Boys Pop Locking Channel. This has some pop lock talk, y'all. Talk your shit. Booyah!
What's pop locking, y'all? It's your favorite pop locker. Big Cool Boy, the Body Puppets, West Coast Pop Lock. I got my shit on today. Hey. I bet you're wondering why I'm sitting more to the side, right? And why I got a chair right here. Hold on. Agony of defeat right here. Parliament. That's that funk. Ladies and gentlemen, this is gonna be the first time I've actually had a pop lock talk where I had somebody come down here and sit right next to me. That's how cold this cat is. I had to have this dude be right here and chop it up with me. The first time somebody came down to Pop Lock Talk. Ladies and gentlemen, on Pop Lock Talk, guess who I'm capped today? Guess who I got on Pop Lock Talk today? The homie Boogaloo Shrimp in the building, Mr. Michael Chambers, a.k.a. Turbo. Woo! I'm going to bring him in. Uh-oh. There he go. Y'all know him. What's pop locking?
What's pop locking? You!
Boogaloo Shrimp.
He make it do what it do.
How you feeling, brother?
It's a blessing to be alive, you know.
Man, ain't it?
That's the truth, brother.
I say it all the time.
It is what it is, right?
Yeah, it is what it is.
I got
is.
My mask and took the temperature.
Oh, you staying safe?
It's all good.
You staying safe.
But I'm on your turf, so I came in peace. That's what we do. We follow rules. The rules.
Hey, you know, that's what my real name means. It's peace.
See what I'm saying? Two. Peace, peace. So speak on it.
Man, I got a lot to talk to you about, homie. This is Pop Lock Talk. We're gonna go into man, what you got going on.
Wait a minute. Back in the days when I was young, I'm not a kid anymore. Some days I sit and wait at the Pop Lock Show.
Ladies and gentlemen, right here live on Pop Lock Talk, Mr. Michael Chambers, aka Boogaloo Shrimp, aka Turbo. Oh. If you don't know who this dude has the most fascinating, the most popular, the most classic scene in the history of pop locking. Hands down, there's not a scene more classical. Yeah, that's a word. More classic than his scene. Ladies and gentlemen, on Pop Lock Talk, Boogaloo Shrimp. Boogaloo Shrimp first, man. If they don't know what scene I'm talking about, it's the scene, ladies and gentlemen, where it's done in front of a liquor store, and this dude got the broom with him, right? And he pushing this broom, and he pushing the broom, and he pop locking with it. That's the most coldest pop locking scene ever, my opinion.
Cool boy.
My opinion.
What they don't know, I was black in L.A., outside a liquor store, and I wasn't drinking.
Well, how they not gonna know that you were black?
Well, because the thing is, people had had a certain MO with other movies that African Americans in LA was at the corner, you know, making it rain, doing all this stuff. But guess what? As God is my witness, I am so glad that that movie showcased African Americans, Mexican, everybody in the industry.
I don't think they know what. Wait a minute, let's slow down. The movie we're referring to is Breaking, you guys, which was released when?
1984.
And the scene, MGM. The scene we're referring to is he has the broom. This is the man.
A janitor right job. And I didn't complain.
Pop locking in front of the store.
Minimum wage.
With the broom. Now, that's a lot of people think that that was a Hollywood mock-up. They think that was Universal Studios.
It was politically correct. I was black. I had a janitor's job in L.A. doing my job, staying in my lane.
What street was that liquor store on?
On Melrose and Heliotrope, right off the 101 freeway. And
I never heard that street in my life.
Heliotrope. What's beautiful about that scene, when I did that scene, guess what? It wasn't on the script. I got the audition.
Are you serious?
I got the audition, and as a 16-year-old kid, I just turned 16, the producers and the director said, you know how we found you? I'm like, how? They go, not from Shabadoo. He didn't have that much juice in Hollywood. He was a locker, but he didn't have that much juice to just hire somebody. They said they needed characters, Turbo and Ozone, the best of the best at the time. This was after Flashdance, for the record. Before Breaking, it was Flashdance, not Wild Style.
I remember Flashdance.
Flashdance did like $93 million in the box. It was a phenomenal amount of money. And what happened was the producers of Breaking, they were looking at the money going, let me show you something. All righty then. No. They went Jim Carrey like, all righty then. No. Instead, okay now. They said, wait a minute. Instead of having actors play street dancers, let's get the real street dancers. Never been done because we weren't actors. It was not theater. It's like, my God, I'd like to win this award. No. They said, let's go in the hood and find the real deal. So they sent out some people like talent scouts. And they're like, okay, well, we found Shabadoo because he was supposed to be the choreographer. But because he was the Latin guy, Orlando, and he had that Puerto Rican thing going, they go, okay, we found the guy, but who's going to play Turbo? So they said, dang, we need a little guy that's like a dynamite. Look at his name, Turbo. Lightning, but that can cooperate on the set. That wasn't too ghetto. They went to the city of Carson. And at the time, the rap group, the Booyah Tribe, the Usos, Mahalo Nui.
Booyah Tribe, right? Matter of fact, Cobra, we looking for you, homie.
Hey, Donald. So check this out. Donald DeVoe, Paul, Danny, and all them, they had a group called the Blue City Strutters.
Right.
And they had that Fillmore strut from up north. It wasn't Boogaloo. Jack and Charlie, the two Samoan twins, you know, they were locking, you know, Dickie Goa, Navy 2 Asasopo, all those Usos brought that up north Fillmore strut style down to Carson. So I was like, okay, back then, you just like fighting, you got to be underground and you got to fight to get a title, right? So I was putting in work coming from Wilmington, California and East Los Angeles because I was dancing against people from Uncle Jam's Army to Long Beach to Pico Rivera. And then I moved all the way to Hollywood. Then when I went up against people like that, they were like, dang, okay, where else do you go? They said, there's one guy that you need to go head up with to get respect in the South Bay. I'm like, who is that? Donald DeVoe. And the thing is, Donald DeVoe was a student of Jack and Charlie. He was their star dancer. I mean, the Blue City Strutters, that was their junior. So I was like, okay. And if he didn't win, he could get a beating because they were a gang. So it was like, okay, you know what? I'm going to come with respect, but it's my honor as a dancer and on my life and on my mom, I got to just prove myself. So I came to Carson. And it was a big John's Hall, and everybody in popping history talked about that battle. I never went up against anything like that because I knew the bop style from Bopping Andre and Tick and Dave because I learned from the Banning and Carson games at Fremont High School, that kind of style, Robot Prince and Tangerine.
Yeah.
So by the time I went against them, Donald could hit. I mean, Cobra had the hit, but he didn't know that I already knew bop and animation on it. So we were going round after round after round after round, and eventually people said I beat him.
This is you and who?
Me and Donald DeVoe from the Blue City Strutters.
Okay.
Best thing about that.
What was his nickname?
His name, I don't know his nickname, but look, it's very true. You look at the documentary Breaking and Entering, and you'll see Donald and Jack and Charlie and Crow and the dancers in Scott Park dancing. Before that happened, I went against them, and guess what? I came out with no beating but respect. Because now, instead of just being a one black African-American in Wilmington, I could walk up Avalon and go, don't beat me up because I know some gang members. No. The thing is, back then, that you would get chin checked if you walked in somebody's neighborhood.
That's real.
So I will walk up Avalon, look at the essays, and look at everybody and say, excuse me, I got people to see and things to do. And guess what? The Samoans like, what's up? Cousin Micaela, they gave me my Uso name, right? So I was hanging out at Scott Park, and I was like, damn, people were like, who is this guy? And he's still walking. I'll be walking up Avalon like, So for the record, what happened was, those styles, almost like mixed martial arts, meant bopping, strutting, ticking. Look at how many styles I was getting. We were absorbing styles. By the time I got into show business, when I did the movie Breaking, the Electric Boogaloos, everybody was out. Everybody was there. The Locker, they were there. But when the studio said, we want Turbo, the thing is, I had no idea who was in the audience. I was, Big John's Hall was a big, big hall. And it was crowded. And the thing is, I was going head up with Donald. And when I won, the guy who wrote the movie, who wrote the script, David Zito, who's on the thing, he came back and told Cannon Films, we found Turbo. They're like, what? We found him. His name is Boogaloo Shrimp. So the next thing I know, Shabadoo was like, wait a minute. He got hired? You guys like him? He's in my group. See, Shabadoo was trying to... Shabadoo at the time, you got to remember, he had already had his time with the Lockers. That was in the 70s, a rerun in Raj. So in the 80s, he was like the shot caller now. Okay, I got a new group of people, and I'm running this. You know, he was that Chi-Town hustler. Okay, I got Coco. I got Shrimp. What do you want? I got Anna. I got everything because I'm the guy. So he actually brought us to Hollywood individually, but then we had to carry our weight. So it makes sense how Turbo and Ozone had two different styles. He was being the Latin lover. I was just putting in work. That's why he said, go get him. He had to hold me back because I had solos.
So Shrimp.
Solos for days.
Shrimp, you said that the classic scene.
Yes, the broom.
Happened by mistake.
Accident. What happened was I was clowning around. Think about it. I'm a 16-year-old kid, still in school, but I had a studio teacher. So now I'm hired on a film set. A kid at 16 doesn't realize a job is a job. You just still have fun, right? So I'm messing around at Debbie Reynolds' studio while the break, and I'm balancing a broom on my hand. And all the producers and the directors are looking at me. I was like, do I owe any money? Because they're just looking at me like, because they're thinking, whoa, this could be in the movie. Everything was off page. I'm balancing my broom on my hand and floating. They're like, it looks like Fred Astaire. Do you remember, they were Jewish. L'chaim, Shmulek, Shmuck. They're like, I think we have something. He looked like a black Fred Astaire, or maybe illegitimate Gene Kelly. Yeah. So they're talking, going, I think we have something. I'm like, okay. They're like, please get the prop person. They got a prop person. Everybody's doing this stuff to me. They're like, just keep dancing. They got my broom. They drilled a hole. They put fishing string. Please continue. Okay, put the music on. So I'm dancing. Now they're looking as a theatrical piece. See, with edits, you could make a piece. I was messing around. I'm like, why is everybody showing all this attention to me? They're like, no, there's something here. And they're like, everybody was whispering. I was like, am I in trouble? They're like, no, please continue. I was like, oh, snap. What happened was the movie was done by MGM. Fred Astaire and Gene Kelly, MGM musicals, come on. When I was messing around, they're like, oh, no, we got a hip-hop loose tribute to Fred Astaire. No, they didn't know. So they
that's
were,
why in the movie,
hey man, they when you're that, when you're
when you're when you're inside the liquor store looking in the mirror,
and like
you
I'd
say
like
to, Fred Astaire,
because once they had the scene, then they wrote it and they developed it. They're like, okay, this is what you're gonna do. The setup was this. They told Shabadoo, tell this guy, who do you think you are, Fred Astaire? Yeah. Who? And I'm like, who? They're like, go and sweep.
The award, it's the recognition of my peers that makes all those agonizing days of teaching Ozone everything I know. That's
hey, I don't want to stay here all night, do you?
Award winners don't push brooms.
Oh, yeah? Why don't you go out and sweep, man? Who do you think you are anyway, Fred Astaire?
Who?
Just go on and sweep, knucklehead.
Thank you.
no. Fred Astaire didn't dance like me. But if you look at Fred Astaire's footage, he did dance with a coat rack, but it was a whole other genre. So they pretty much were on this Fred Astaire thing. They didn't want to disrespect Fred Astaire's name because hip-hop was still kind of street. Like, we were like street kids. That was still legitimate. So they didn't want to say, okay, you know what? Now you're going there. Fred Astaire, come on. But when I said that, people were like, oh, snap, because it just was a theatrical piece. The best thing that happened, the box office numbers, the film company called me and said, they want to have a meeting with you. I'm like, oh, no, now what? Because I'm a kid, right? They're like, no, no, please continue. The owner of Canon Film said in his Israeli voice, Shrimp, what you're doing more better than Broom, huh? You make Broom, but we need something different. What can you do better? I was like, okay. So I got to top my Broom? They're like, yeah, please do something different. I was like, oh. I was in the hotel room watching John Carpenter's The Thing. The movie The Thing. There's that one scene where Kurt Russell is trying to figure out who the alien is. He's in the chair and the alien goes up to the ceiling. I go, can I go up the ceiling like a gecko? They went, huh?
So, I'm like, so now you're talking about part two.
Part two, when he asked me, what can you do? I just got out of the hotel watching The Thing by John Carpenter.
Oh.
So when I said that, they were like whispering again. I'm like, what are they talking about? Next thing I know, when I came back to L.A. after the world tour promoting the film, they're like, Shrimp, you have your own scene and it's going to be bigger. It is? They're like, yeah, but it's going to be different. They had the same room called the Gimbal that Fred Astaire did in Royal Wedding. Fred Astaire's other movie where he's dancing and he goes up the ceiling, they had the same room because MGM got it. So they said, okay, now look, just dance and don't look at the camera. And they turned the room, and that's why I was on the ceiling.
Yes.
I'm so excited.
once again, it was another tribute to Fred Astaire.
Again?
Think about it.
So Fred Astaire did something like that.
Fred Astaire is on record. You can go on YouTube, look up Royal Wedding. He has a top hat as and he goes up on the ceiling.
Wow.
MGM knew it, and they were like, dang, Fred Astaire danced with a coat rack. I did the broom, and it worked.
Yeah.
When I went on the ceiling, everybody said, oh, no. Matter of fact, I was working with Michael Jackson at the time. So if you look at that scene, everybody was like, Jeffrey Daniels, Jeffrey Daniels. I was like, oh, I'm so tired of this. I was like, okay, did Michael Jackson do it on the ceiling? So you actually see me moonwalking on the ceiling.
So look, let me ask you this.
Yeah, it's very true.
In the movie Breaking, in part two, how much of it was you improv-ing?
All. Pretty much all.
So did they give you a script?
I just answered it all because
what happened. But did they give you a script?
I'm answering all of it because what happened was when these people decided to make a movie, they didn't really know what they were getting. So when they found us and we were the real deal and they found how we could work as doing scenes, they're like, okay, you know what? They're not actors. They're not reading and doing monologues. Let's put them in a situation. So if you think about it, if you look at the situation, the reason why people were laughing, they would go, okay, look, Shrimp, you're going to go to this party and there's going to be some kind of subtle racist people. They're going to make fun of you. Just say whatever's on your mind. So I'm there. And the lady goes, who are you? I go, I'm one of those guys that, she goes, oh, he's one of those guys that spins on his head. I picked up one of her sarcasm. I went, yeah, I'm one of those guys. How about some of this pink cheese right back at you? Then the guy goes, yeah. Here's a quarter. Why don't you come and dance for us, boy? I spilled water on him. No. They were like, oh, snap. They found my acting niche. I was able to carry my weight by doing situations. I could read, but they're like, no, this guy's improv is off the chain. That's why people were like, damn. One of the actors was gay, but they didn't tell you. But Phoenix, like, boy, he was flaming. Yeah. But look, for me at 16, I didn't understand. That's psychological, right? So they go, okay, look. When they say his nickname, do something. So Kelly goes, yeah, but my friends call him Cupcakes. I went, Cupcakes, your face, your face. No. It worked because it was, once again, improv. So the producers were going, man, this guy's killing his scenes because they just put me in situations. And then to clean it up, if something didn't come out right, they were writing stuff that I could say if it didn't work.
Well, look.
Yeah. So a lot of that was off page.
So look, how soon after did part two come out after the first
one? Here's the answer. Ready? When they had the movie, because listen, in movies, when they film it, the editors are editing and then they got the empty codes. And when they actually have a movie ready for print, they already know where it's going. So the thing is, when we were at the Cannes Film Festival and we were there in Nice, where everybody does a record, when we were there, they sat down and said, look, this is going off the chains because it was already in the UK, United Kingdom, you know what I mean? It was already blowing up. They were from Israel, so they pushed it over there and saw the response and went, oh, we got gold. So by the time we got back, we went right into production from the Breaking Tour. We went right into production Breaking 2 because
right away.
They were saying, dude, you know what? I don't know how long this breakdance is going to be, but keep it going because the money was going. So, we went right into production.
Let me ask you this. With you being a real popper from the streets, mm-hmm. what do you think the movie did for the culture
of pop rock? I'll be very, very honest.
Come on, talk to me.
This when LL Cool J and all those people in New York decided to open the Universal Hip Hop Museum, my little bitty documentary was allowed in there because those people in New York, you know, Rocksteady, all those people, they got a lot of glory. And here we were not really getting the same love. But New York said, no, wait a minute. L.A. does have something. And Boogaloo Shrimp is from L.A. So when they put my documentary into that museum, enough said, because now kids going to the New York City Museum could look back and learn my history from the same streets that we all danced on, Eve After Dark, Mavish Flat, the whole history, because it was like a door open. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it always takes one person for other people to go, okay, what else is there? It's like windows, you turn the page. So for the record, the answer is this. Those movies opened up doors for Japanese, Koreans, all kind of people to come to LA and go, wait a minute, it's not just the Boogaloo. Wait, there's other people. There's the LA Boppers. There's this, there's this. There's lowrider cars. So there's a whole culture. Mm-hmm. And it helped a lot of people get jobs. Mm-hmm. Like yourself, you have kids, and your camp and your dance academy. But you're growing around the world because people are like, wait a minute, I want to learn what it is to be a real OG. So for the record, those movies were like a gateway mm-hmm. for the culture. Okay. And it went from the streets to the stage.
Okay, that's cool. But let me ask you this. Let's steer in a different direction.
Okay.
Let's go back further. Let's go back a little bit more towards the beginning.
Yeah.
What year did you first start getting down? When were you introduced to this dance?
Okay, you ready? When I first got introduced into this dance, I was at a house party in like 1978 when Grease and Saturday Night Fever and all that stuff was up. I was at a house party in Wilmington. Mm-hmm. And the lady who gave the house party, her nephew was from Long Beach. So it was Mark Benson, Boogaloo King Tut from the Sterling Silver Dancers in Long Beach, who came to Wilmington.
So that dude is real.
I'm answering
Mark Benson.
So look, I'm answering your question. So I was at a house. No, I'm answering your question.
No, I hear you answering my question, but it's a story behind Mark Benson and Boogaloo Tut because another Boogaloo Tut from the Electronic Puppets.
But I'm saying on point to answer your question.
Go ahead.
So here's the deal. So I'm just a little kid in the 70s. Okay. I'm at a party. And there's a lot of people dancing. You got Donna Summers playing. You got Foxy, all the good 70s music. You know, freak out. This guy, Mark Benson, comes in a white painter's outfit. Usually, if you didn't paint, that looked clean, dude. It was all white. He's standing there. Bow, bow. He starts doing something I've never seen. And it was beyond the robot. It wasn't Slim the robot. No, he was hitting. And it was phenomenal. I was like this. Wow. Because, you got to remember, at the time, as a kid, I'm watching The Bionic Woman. I'm watching Steve Austin, The $6 Million, all this stuff on television. I go to a party, and I see somebody that looks like me with the same skin color, and he's dancing like Giant Robot. I'm like, whoa. So I'm receiving this, but I wasn't taught. Mm-hmm. After I saw that party, I go to my seventh grade year at my junior high school. Same thing. First semester, teachers are like, okay, kids, sit down. Sitting in the class, and the teacher left, so it was boring. Samoan dude from Carson with an afro like a black guy gets up, starts doing the scarecrow. I'm like, all the girls are like, ugh. I'm like, ooh, he's getting girls? I'm like, damn. So my friend, like, look at all the girls he's getting. Because they're like, ooh. They thought he was black, but he was Samoan with an afro. So he was like, I was like, damn, man, he gets ladies, and he's ugly. You know, because, guys have to diss each other so we just, get the girls, right? So I'm like, he's ugly, but look at all the girls he's getting. I know. So we're like, okay, let's practice. So me and my friends are practicing, and I have my scarecrow. By the time Stacey Hawkins came, I had scoped out every popper that was in ninth grade, and I had my own little routine that I would do at sports night. I didn't know that the more you practice, you got better. So by the time I went to Banning High School, the teacher said, we heard about you. I go, you heard about me? They're like, yeah, we want you on the drill team. I go, that's for sissies. They go, don't say that. The drill team, you can perform at the football. I go, what? They go, if we put you on the field, you got a whole. I go, okay. So my mom made my little outfit, and I was a Banning. If you know Banning High School, Banning Pilot, he looked like a pirate. He had an eye patch, and they had a red jacket, and Banning color was red and black. So they put me out there with the cheerleaders. I'm telling you what, Banning played Edison. I was at the Anaheim Convention Center, Anaheim State. Boom, and I was dancing. Everybody and their grandma was talking about the little black kid from Wilmington. I became Boogaloo Shrimp.
That's how you got the name.
That's how I became. They said, okay, we got a title. You are a Boogaloo Shrimp. Everybody, did you see that little guy? No. Then, after the high school love, people was like, oh, if you really want to get funky and you want to put your skills, go to the Uncle Jam's Army Dance. I'm like, what is that? They're like, take your little quarter, get on that Torrance bus, and go that way on PCH and go to Long Beach and go to Shoreline Village because they had the convention center. That was Uncle Jam's Army. I'm telling you what, those guys at the Hutch, Time Bandits, all those guys, it looked like the movie The Warriors. When I walked in to Uncle Jam's Army, Deuce, Bobatron, the Time Bandits, the Electric Boogaloos, everybody was there, and I was just like this little kid, but I had a name, Boogaloo Shrimp. And right there in the lobby, Popping Taco was like, "Are you Boogaloo Shrimp?" I go, "Yeah." He goes, "Well, I'm Papa Taco." And I told my friend, "He's that Mexican, they said, that dance better than black people." Because I'm a kid, right? But back then, we ain't never heard no Mexican dancing better than blacks. So we were like, "I got to see this." Oh, my God. Bruno went in there and started battling everybody. Nobody wanted to come out. So Deuce, East Coast Deuce, was like, "Look, I don't want nobody to hurt you. This is a grown man's game." Because there were a lot of thugs there. He's all, "Look, you stick with me and just say you're my little brother, right?" Everybody's like, "Hey, man, Deuce." And there's, you know, then, "Hey." So he's like, "We're going to make sure you get out of here." I'm like, "All right." So the thing is, Poppy Taco said, "Look, do you need a ride? Do you need a ride to practice somewhere?" I go, "Yeah, but you got to meet my mom and dad." So when my mom and dad met him, they're like, "What are you going to do to our son?" He goes, "Mrs. Chambers, we're going to take him to Long Beach. My family's going to make sure he's safe, and we're going to practice." Changed my life. Because I didn't catch a beating, because there was a lot of gangs, man. I mean, if you're one, they would have just destroyed you, right? Especially in Long Beach. Come on now. So I wasn't claiming anything, but I needed to practice. So Bruno came with his Camaro in Wilmington, picked me up, took me off of PCH, took me to his house, and we practiced in that garage and breaking in and entering. But it wasn't just him. Anthony, King Cobra, all these people that were in Bruno's world would come there to see this little guy, Boogaloo Shrimp. And the one that actually helped us get work was Shabadoo. See, Shabadoo later was looking to start hiring dancers to surround himself, right? So we're just practicing and winning contests. Next thing I know, Chain Reaction, Tom Gubbins, Sanchez, Paul, and all those guys from the Valley. Everybody was tuning in on what was happening in Long Beach. Remember, Noah's Ark, you know, Grand Sister Station, that was the place, right? So everybody was like, "Shoot, what's going on in Long Beach?" Everybody, we had Mysterious Poppers, Time Bandits. So me and Bruno were practicing, and the word got out, like, "Hey, dancers are making money." I'm like, "Legally? Yeah. How?" They're like, "On videos." What's that? MTV just came out. So if you made your way to Venice Beach, they would make you sign a release, Taft Harley, and you'd be in a music video. Most of those guys in those music videos, they got paid like a couple $100 to just do their stuff. But look at the Gap Band Party Train. That was my first music video.
So Shrimp, you've done some work with Michael Jackson. Tell me what that was like.
I was an interesting experience because, like, if we go back, me and Bruno were dancing in the garage in Long Beach, and sure enough, they had Channel 7 had a thing where Paul Moyer, they did INLA, did a thing on street dance, and they told everybody, be at the corner of Hollywood and Highland,
excuse me,
and do your best, and they're gonna interview the best out of the best. So we were at Hollywood Boulevard, just everybody would be posted up on the corner, Hollywood and Highland, and sure enough, everybody was there, and Paul Moyer interviewed me, mm-hmm. Little Coco Cosmo, the late Jason, Sugar Pop's brother Jason, and Poppin' Taco, and sure enough, when they said, "Okay, do what you guys do," we all had a chance to solo. I had no idea that somebody that was on the, you know, when you film, you have grips and gaffers. Somebody who was on the Channel 7 thing knew the Jacksons. So right after, she's like, "Hey, look, here's my business card. Have your mother and father call us." Because that was like, Jackson was like, that was like, zip. So the thing is, I gave the information to my mom, and her next thing, my mom's like, "This is MJJ Production. This is the Jacksons, right?" So my mom's like, "Oh, snap. You're going to go meet Michael Jackson?" I'm like, "Are you serious?" She goes, "Well, yeah, they're saying, but you can't say nothing, but you're going to go." So the lady had people pick us up, like Uber in the day, and make sure we didn't bring anything. They searched us. They said, "Okay, now look, you're not going to tell anybody where this address is." Next thing you know, me and Bruno were like, "Oh, snap. We're in Encino, California at the gate of the Jacksons." I'm like, "Why?" I'm looking at Bruno like, the gate opens. They're like, "Okay, just do what you do." We go in, security checks us again on two checks. I'm like, "Damn." We go in there, I'm like, I see Catherine. She's in the kitchen, "Hello." I'm like, "Okay." I didn't know she was Michael's mom. I didn't know. So then Michael's like, "Hello." And then he goes, "Oh," we're like, "Oh." And we're like, he's like, "It's okay, come in." His little voice, "Come on." So we go inside and we're like, "Oh no." Michael's, "Oh, it's okay. And I'm like, there's LaToya, Joe, Janet, Marlon, and Tito. They didn't care nothing about dancing.
So when you got there, they were all just doing their normal thing
I'm a walking in their house? Through. When they brought us through, the brothers that didn't dance, they didn't care what Michael was doing. They were already started, whatever. He's just messing around with his toys. But Michael's like, had that look like, okay, come with me. Tito, Marlon, and Jackie were like, whatever. I mean, they had an attitude because they don't dance. Whatever. So Janet was like this. Oh, no, I'm going to get a show. Janet was, I mean, she had that smile. Rebe was like, LaToya was like, whatever. Like, come on, I'm bored. They were like the Kardashians. Whatever, get to the point. Michael had that face like, okay, you ready? This is Boogaloo Shrimp, and that's Papa Taco. Everybody, Joe Jackson's like, looking. He's like, okay, you ready? I'm so nervous. There was no bathroom. I was like, oh, my God. Michael goes, just do what you do. I'm like, okay, do or die. I guess I got to do it. I just lost my mind, man. I just boom, 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 start doing all this stuff.
So wait a minute. So he brought had you there. On the platform so you could dance in front of his family?
He brought us in.
Now, I was told.
To show. I'm telling you the truth.
Look, I feel you telling me the truth. Yeah. I'm not challenging you. No, I just want to ask you some questions.
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay. So I was told from another interview that Mike came in and didn't really have a sound system. Did he have one then?
Yes, he did.
Okay. And you were in his living room, backyard, bedroom? Where exactly were you?
If you see that documentary, The Jackson's American Dream, that was the only correct visual thing that explained how the, because they actually used the house. So if you look at that, if that documentary, I mean that film, right there in the kitchen, there was a rehearsal hall right behind it.
Oh.
And he had a really big stereo set. That's where they would rehearse in privacy, right behind the kitchen. So as we came in through the security, Michael said, we went through the kitchen. That's when I seen Katie. She was in the kitchen. Went right to the rehearsal hall. In the rehearsal hall, that's where Janet and Joe and Rebe and all them were right there. But we didn't realize it. But what happened was the lady that saw us on Hollywood, she said, guess what? I found two guys that may be interesting if you learn from them. Because he had already watched the INLA show. He was watching the news. And said, I want that guy and that guy. So, I mean, Michael has an archive of video. So he saw us from the Channel 7 thing. So he said, I want to meet that person, that person. So they said, oh, got you. So she brings us back. Rest was history. Because Pop and Taco and me have two different styles. Very different. So when I did my solo, I had the animation and the bob. Bruno back then was just sticking and doing the boogaloo. So it makes sense because I got hired to just jam and practice with Michael for his solos. Bruno got hired to do the routines. Captain EO, all that pomping, that was Bruno.
So what exactly did you teach Mike?
Well, I'm going to answer that with just video of Michael because you as a boxer and as an artist, if one of your students comes out of this gym, they should see the cool boy style or the cool boy style fighting. Same with Michael. When I was practicing with Michael, it wasn't 5, 6, 7, 8. I just did what I did. He was a professional, right? But the best thing that happened, every time that man danced and he soloed, you could see his animation, or at least trying, not at our level, but you saw the animation. You saw him. Now, this is gonna blow your mind. I was bopping and doing the dime stop. But Michael Jackson was very clever because he didn't want to look like a street dancer. So by the time 1987 came, Michael did the bop, but he didn't do the hands. But when he did bad, look at bam.
What you mean by he didn't want to look like a street dancer?
Just what I said, because he never gave street dancers credit. He was always the king of pop. He was always numero uno. So
how did that make you feel?
I guess like any other person, it's like, dang, you know, I did all this for my boss. They don't get credit. But I didn't complain about it. I was just like, you know what? Because I did movies. I didn't stay in the street. I did two movies and went on to do other stuff.
So how, when you guys was training, how long would you get out?
So back to the session. When I came in there and I did my thing and Bruno did his thing, that wasn't the end of it. Because now Michael could pick who he wanted to learn from when he wanted to learn. So for the record, that was 1983, just before we went on tour with Lionel Richie. So here it goes. I wasn't still in the streets. When Michael Jackson saw me on INLA and he brought me and Bruno to his house, he got a chance to get to know the anime and see it, right? And then he had a chance to see Bruno's style. But he didn't stop there, because right after that, we got on tour with Lana Richie for 9 months. Mm. Dance with Lana Richie, okay?
That's dope.
And Lana Richie and Michael wrote, "We Are the World." So the story goes, now that I was working with his fellow Motown mate, he was like, "Oh, snap, this guy's the real deal." So right after the tour, me and Shabadoo did the movie Breaking. Bruno, he did the movie Breaking, but in Breaking 2, he didn't really have the words, you know, he didn't have lines. So after Breaking 2, we went on to do other things. Bruno said, "Okay, I'm gonna go back with Michael," which makes sense because.
But hold on, you didn't answer my question.
Okay.
My question was, when you were training with Mike, how much time would you spend with him? How long would you guys?
Whatever his career allowed. I mean, I would say right now, if. Whoever has the archive videotapes of what, because he videotaped everything. And of course, they kept that on the download because, of course, my.
I mean, name, would you guys get out for an hour?
You know what? I mean, you're talking about when I was 14. I didn't put a timer on the adults, but we did jam session. Yeah. And the few times.
How did he treat you? Was he cool with
you? He showed me respect, and it was none of that propaganda that people diss on him. But for the record, I'm going to make it very cut and dry. That man was a genius because I didn't have to teach him 5, 6, 7, 8. Michael be like, just do it again.
Just get out.
No. He was like, just please continue.
Yeah.
No. He was like, do it again. I'm like, the same thing. Just keep going. I was like, damn. No, but he like was trying to get me to just kind of keep doing it so he could learn, right? And the thing is, I had no idea he was learning his solo.
Now, what year was this?
This 1983 was when we first met each other. And we started jamming, but it was just before the Victory Tour, which was important because when him and his brothers did the Victory Tour, anybody that sees his live Billie Jean will know, okay, something was different about his Billie Jean solo, because when he did the Motown Billie Jean, he just did the one step backwards and the world went boom, but it didn't stop there because I met him right after Motown. So when we jam session, I had the circular float. I was going front, back, side. I was doing so much that he was like, "Oh, snap." So the thing is, that first session with me and him, when he did Billie Jean, the live version, you could see Billie Jean, he's going around in a circle and then he throws his hat. That's when I knew, okay, now I know what he's getting from me, because I didn't do choreography. Oh, Michael was like, well, you know how solos are, right?
Okay.
It makes sense. Yeah. Bruno was the one that knew how to do choreography, not me.
So I see how it went down.
He split us.
He watched you get down.
There you go.
And he took what he wanted to take from
you. It makes sense, huh?
Okay.
But it makes sense, right?
Yeah. You still taught him. I'm still teaching him.
It is.
But he took what he wanted to take. Okay, that makes a lot of sense. Okay. Right on, man. So, I mean, you know, a lot of people don't get to work with Michael Jackson, but I'm challenging the fact that he didn't want to be a street dancer, but he come get the best LA street dancers there were to teach him.
But here's the same thing. Now, you ready? When he did The Way You Make Me Feel, it's on the record that he hired gang members, Crips, real Crips, and put them in his video. And he even wore a blue flannel, and there's pictures of him throwing up the seat. But he didn't hang with gang members. He didn't continue supporting it. But he used that to make his video.
Yeah.
So he was using whatever he needed for his agenda.
Mm.
But it wasn't just me, it was everything. Because that's what corporations...
How do you feel about that?
Well, you know what? The way the world is, I can go on and on about my opinion, but you know what? I learned to just, whatever God wills, it's God's will. At the end of the day, he's not here, but his legacy's here. And no matter, even if I was lying, the thing is, every time that man danced, anybody that reviews his videos, if they know my style, there's a little bit of me in all of his performances and his solos. So that makes me feel good because I don't have to do this. I don't have to say nothing because from all the work that I put out there, even at 14, even when I did the Tour de France, that was more advanced than he did at that time. So I never had to dispute or back up my stuff. I let my dance prove what I'm about. So I kind of feel this way now that we're at the COVID 2022 and the world's divided and there's this and that, and everybody's poking fun at each other's races, for us to have our legacy of the LA streets on record with somebody great like Michael and all these BTS, all these other people who learned from Michael, it's like having a martial arts style that just keeps on going to other people. We had a popping style that went from old school 80s to now BTS popping the Jabberwockies World of Dance. So it's really beautiful to be in our 50s and look back and see how far the dance has come. Beyond Michael Jackson.
Yeah. Hey man, you're known for having one of the dopest glides and backslides ever. When was it, was there ever a time where you was like, man, my glide is getting good, or I want to master gliding? How did that come about? Or did someone teach you? Did you pick it up?
It's very simple. That's all I knew how to do. No, think about it.
So in the beginning, specialty?
Listen, I didn't have that many moves, but when my name came up, they're like, oh, he can glide. So that was my thing. It's like, I didn't boogaloo, I didn't robot, I glided. So that's all I did. They're like, Trimp, do your thing. I glided until I ripped my holes in my shoes. That's all I did until I learned stuff. So I mastered it because I couldn't do anything else. But I mastered it so well, here it goes, that Michael Jackson, out of all the people, had me in his house showing him, teaching him, even after Motown, and he became the master of the move. So I stopped doing it. You know why? I didn't want to be a Michael Jackson impersonator. After Michael Jackson created the moonwalk and that was a machine, I was like, why do I have to do that step? I have many others. If that will make him appease his world of pop stars and he's known for the moonwalk, guess what? He can't do this.
So you taught Mike on the moonwalk?
I taught him my glide combo.
Okay.
Now look, I just answered you. I taught him my glide combo. Back then, everybody in the hood was backsliding, mm-hmm. but how did you round it up? So I would backslide and then float in a circle. So I taught him my glide combo.
Okay.
But guess what? It's on record because, like I told you, if we go back, after Motown, he just did the backslide. But when he met me, he learned how to go around in the circle. Mm-hmm. When he showed it on the at the Victory Tour, enough said, because now a little piece of my first session was on record with him.
He ever give you a props?
You know what? I'm going to answer that. And this bugged me, my family, and everybody else. Well, Oprah Winfrey called him on it at Neverland. Oprah Winfrey sat down and said, who taught you the moonwalk? That was when he's the king of pop and he was already selfish. He's like, well, I remember I practiced with three kids in the ghetto, but I made it better. He still couldn't give it up. Even in the book Moonwalker, it said Michael learned the moonwalk from three street kids. And I was like, oh man, of course it hurt, because I mean, can you imagine?
What three kids he named?
Now look, he didn't name anybody, but we know who those other two were. Cooley Jackson from Solid Gold and Alpha and Deputy. I think either Cooley Jackson from Solid Gold, Alpha Deputy, or Casper. One of those two guys.
Alpha that was here today?
I don't know Alpha was here today, but there were two guys that were always around Soul Train and around that Michael
now,
Jackson.
Now, I hear Casper a lot.
Okay, so they're not here, and I'm not going to jock them, Michael specifically named three street dancers that he worked with. And of course, I had a combo, but they just did the backside, because Soul Train, back then, everybody was doing the backside. And it could have been Jeffrey Daniels, but he didn't say it. He never said Jeffrey's name. He never said my name. So for me, for the record, of course, as a black man trying to pay bills with his art and blah, 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 I was like, okay, if you don't get it, for me, it was like getting a credit from him would have been like I graduated from USC or Pepperdine in the arts, because that was the pinnacle of art. If you taught Elvis, you should have your ticket written. But if you taught somebody like Michael but didn't get credit, you had to do day labor job because there's nobody else that's gonna hire you. So for me, I was like, dang, you know what? I gotta work harder, because the credit that could have been my dream job went, but guess what?
Yeah.
Best thing that happened, people in the industry knew the truth, because I never stopped dancing in the industry. People in the industry were like, wait a minute, This guy went from Lionel Richie to the movie Breaking to Breaking 2 to Dancing with Paula Abdul to the robot Steve Urkel. All this, wait a minute. Why would anybody dispute that he worked with Michael? Mm. See, it would have been different if I kept harping, no, I'm the guy that taught Michael. And then the 80s went and the 90s went, and I'm still saying, no, but I still work. I never said that. I just kept working right. And let my work speak for itself.
That's right.
You know, it's very true.
I believe, Shrimp. I mean, hey, man, this is Pop Lock Talk, and it's about allowing you to tell your story, and I'm not going to challenge your story.
No, yeah.
So I appreciate your time.
No, that's good.
But here, I got a question for you.
Yes, sir.
Are you familiar with the comedian Bill Bellamy?
Yes, and I didn't like what he said because it's not true.
So it's not true. So tell the world right now.
So look, for the record, what Bill Bellamy said, his version of the story was not true. And the thing is, this is the truth. When I met Bill Bellamy, he was the star of MTV's Beach House or whatever. He's not from L.A. He's from New York, but he was here in Rancho Palos Verdes, San Pedro, where we had Marine Lamb, doing his thing with Carmen Electra, doing MTV's thing. I happened to be in the area, and somebody said, hey, you know what? They're filming there. I went up there, and he looked at me like, what? I'm a little shrimp. He goes, so? So he had an attitude because he was the top dog, and I was a former dancer, but he was a star, not a break dancer. So it was kind of awkward, but I walked away because you know what? He was in L.A., and I did not kiss anybody.
What would make that dude say something like that? Why do you think he did that? To get some fame?
Think about it. I'm going to answer your question. What is social media to tell something that people don't know?
Yeah.
Out of all those years, he's in a car going, guess what? Back in the day, I'm in Boogaloo Shrimp. And he put it out there so that people could try to believe something that didn't happen. But if it was really true, how come he didn't say it on his other shows? How come it took him years for social media? Right? No. Think about it.
Nice check.
Don't believe everything that's out there because people could say this against this president and this, but the media is feeding you what you want to learn.
Bill Bellamy.
It's very true.
Stop lying on the homeboy Shrimp.
Quit getting it twisted. Homie.
Tell the right story, homie.
He's laughing. And he's laughing.
Don't let us pull up, homie. Shrimp got some homeboys like Cool Boy.
But you know what? No. I ain't mad at people because there's people that say whatever for their little 15 minutes. I could say one thing and be wrong, but
how did it make you feel?
Kind of brokenhearted because I was like you said, why are you going to say that? Just for a few 15 minutes of whatever? I mean, Jimmy Kimmel and Garth Brooks dissed me in a comedy roast. It didn't hurt my feelings, but I got a call from Peaches Rodriguez. She said, you need to turn on the television. Jimmy Kimmel and Garth Brooks just mentioned you, and people are going, did you rip off somebody? I'm like, wait. If you look at Jimmy Kimmel and Garth Brooks write a country song, if you don't know that Jimmy Kimmel's a comedian, it could make me look bad because Jimmy Kimmel asked Garth Brooks, I want to learn how to write a country song. Garth's like, okay, what's the subject? He goes, back in the day, my friend wanted to learn how to break dance, wanted to learn dance lessons. So me and my friend said, well, you need to call Michael Boogaloo Shrimp Chambers and learn from him. So Jimmy Kimmel said, yeah, I paid to hire Boogaloo Shrimp. He took the money and never he said that. And it was a comedy roast, but people were like, whoa, wait a minute.
And he said this on what show?
He said it on his show, and I think it was on Taste of Country. My point is this. It was a joke that went flat because it made me look like I was robbing people's money. So the thing is, TMZ came back and said, do you want to answer that? Thank you, TMZ. Because TMZ contacted me and said, do you want to answer this? So I cleared it up because...
That's cool. Because people shouldn't do that because...
But they do.
That can make you look like you handle bad business.
A lot of people do stuff, man.
You know? Yeah.
Well, but I'm sure when you do these kind of shows, you're going back and people make blogs about this person and that, but you're clearing up a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
While we're still alive, so that we get at least a fair chance, right?
Right, and it's tough out here, man.
It's very tough
for dancers and pop lockers, period.
Yep.
And then when people want to add extra on,
that's worse.
That makes it worse. That's messed up. But anyway, enough of that, Shrimp.
But I'm glad you cleared that up. Thank you.
Yeah, most definitely, man. And if there's anything else you want to clear up,
well, you can
use
what?
This platform.
And I do want to clear up something for the record. No matter what anybody says, LA has always been united in the arts. It don't matter where I did movies or whatever. at the end of the day, when you guys see what happened at this competition, it reminded me about the kids we were playing in the streets. Because we were just kids before the money turned everybody out. Put the music on. Put your A-track on. You know? I mean, just dance and go head up. And that's exactly what this was, you know? And you know what? It just reminded me, you know, going back in the day, instead of a movie telling your story, that was real. That was, like, really real.
What he's referring to, ladies and gentlemen, tonight we had
the battle.
My head up pop locking battle here at Cool Boys Boxing Camp and Dance Academy. And Shrimp, I guess you really enjoyed that.
You know what? I already knew what to expect, but when I was there, I was like, wow, you know what? All the people that were my all-stars in the neighborhood, you know, Take A Lot, Prince, Scorpio, and then to see the new generation battling against the legends, I was just like, whoa, man. I mean, it was amazing. It was amazing to see the timeline and the art, the pure art.
Who is someone who stood out, man, that really impressed you?
I have to admit, I don't know his name, and I should.
Not tonight.
In I'm the popping?
About, yeah, in pop locking, period.
I gotta say, you ready?
Yeah.
And I hope he's still alive. The guy that I used to trip out on, Triplett, when I met Bopping Andre, and I seen Triplett, it was probably 1980, 81 at a high school football game. And I saw Triplett when he was young, and I saw Andre when he was young. And I'm telling you, Andre's bop was it was like, for me, I seen Robot Prince, but Andre was like two times more different than Robot Prince. He looked like a Clash of the Titans kind of Jason and the Argonauts guy. I was like, wow. I mean, his robot was like, I just saw Sinbad and the Golden Voyages, and it looked like one of the guys, right? Then that guy Triplett, I had to actually lean in to see if this guy was like a strobe light, because look at his name, Triplett. People could pop, they could tick, but then they vibrate. Triplett was doing all three. He would go brrr, so it was like a blur. Wait a minute, what did you brrr? And then he was so hyped, he was like brrr, and we're like, whoa, he was ticking. I was like, oh man. So for me, that resonated. Okay, when I do my robot, I gotta have those 30-second notes. Brr, brr. That's where my animation was being developed. It makes sense, huh? Yeah. I didn't just hit. I was like, brr, brr, brr. It was like machine gun ticking because of Triplett. So he did stand out, and so did Bopping Andre.
Triplett, man. Pop Lock, love to you. We gotta get you on Pop Lock Talk. Shrimp is talking highly about you.
That guy, man.
Shrimp, tell me, man. Tell me one of the best moments you've had with this dance.
The best moment?
One of the best moments.
Okay. 1997. I was on Jam on the Groove. Popping and the whole West Coast, East Coast, Biggie, Tupac. That whole East Coast, West Coast thing was booming in the 90s. You had Tupac and Biggie, and it was just no dancing. It was all about thuggish, right? So I couldn't really get a real job dancing over here, so I had to go on a dance tour. So Tony Basil said, you need to go on this dance tour, make you some money, right? So they hired me, and I joined the tour, but I danced with Orko from Air Force Crew. Mm. I danced with Remind from Style Elements.
Oh, wow.
It was Doc and Adesla, Mr. Wiggles, Fable, Crazy Legs, all these people on
the East Coast,
on a hip hop musical. So I was like, okay, now I'm a grown man. People keep talking about breaking and blah blah blah. Like if that was given to me on a silver platter. So it was like on my honor to show everybody, no, I'm the real deal, and I'm going in your country and on your set. Put you in check. Ooh. So I was on that tour, and Mr. Wiggles and Ken Swift, that was when the cameras were rolling.
Yeah.
Mr. Wiggles was still from Rocksteady, and he wasn't with the Boogaloos. He was still Rocksteady.
Uh-huh.
But he was watching my solos, and each time we performed, solos were different. Cameras kept rolling. When I got off the tour, Zulu Gremlin and Mr. Wiggles had Mr. Wiggles' business. And some of those videos were our solos. But Mr. Wiggles got really, really good at animation and robot because of the tour.
Really?
And then he joined the Electric Boogaloos. So now he had the Boogaloo style and the animation style and Mr. Wiggles business. So for me, I was so glad that I put it down on that show around the world because other people saw the change before everybody started making money off the style and selling DVDs. Okay. And makes sense, huh? Okay. So if you had a passport, you made a lot of money teaching.
Okay. Okay.
So you see where I'm going with this? That was my favorite time in my life.
Dope.
Because I realized, okay, if I don't put it down now, the train might leave and there goes shrimp. Oh, it was just breaking. People have been doing all this, but I put it down in Asia. Then people from the K-pop generation, Korea and all, anything in Japan resonated out in China. So a lot of those dancers were watching the underground stuff that we put down. Next thing I know, when the Step It Up movies came, and when B-Boying came back, those guys from Japan were no joke, huh? Really? They could hit. They were doing contests. They were jesting. I mean, stuff out of Asia, those guys were hitting. But guess what? I had a little bit of my style and a lot of the great dancers like Poppin' John, all those frantic, all those superheroes of dance. They all came up to me and said, "Thank you, Shrimp," because they were learning
from
my solo. So that was my favorite time because I didn't even realize how important it was.
Hey, man. In the sitcom with Urkel, Steve Urkel, was that you and the robot?
Yes.
Tell me about that.
So.
And what's the name of that show?
That's Family Matters.
Family Matters.
So for the record, this is what happened. I did a movie called Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey, part two of Excellent Adventure with Keanu. Oh, yeah, man. Yeah. So look. Yeah. Yeah. Totally, Matt. Ah! So look, that's Bill and Ted. Whoa. That's air guitar.
Okay.
So look,
okay.
I got an audition because I told my agent, I'm tired of being the kid with the boombox. I don't want to break dance with linoleum. Mm. I want something more. She's like, what are you talking about? Julie McDonald at MSA. I said, Julie, I don't want to be the guy in the rap video twerking. I want to do something real. Mm-hmm. I want George Lucas or Steven Spielberg to see me. I want to be like a Negro R2-D2. She's like, what? I go, just send me out on a special effects job.
Yeah.
I had no idea. When you tell your agent what you're looking for, they tend to start looking for that. I told my agent that. They said, I know, you got to call for a job. It's in Santa Clarita. It's a movie, Bill and Ted's. Mm-hmm. Okay, what am I going to do? Oh, you're going to do your robot. Okay. I go over there. Whoa. Now, the director was like, oh, my God. Let's see, you're gonna play a robot, but let's see what you do. Man, I went in there, but he goes, you got the job. No, because you can imagine Keanu Reeves and Alex Winter, they don't robot, but we were like the most excellent robot. Yeah! Yeah! So look, if anybody's seen that movie, they would know the robots rocked. I mean, you know, mm-hmm. God gave rock and roll. Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, man. So look, I did that, but I had no idea the people I was working with, Kevin Yeager, special effects, Kevin Yeager, Kenny Myers, all these great special effects like people, they were the ones who put the suit together. So after the movie, I'm in Hawaii, right? And I get another call, because back then, you didn't have Facebook. I had my little recorder machine, right? Answering service. So then my mom goes, you need to check the service, you got another job. So I check the service, and this guy, Kenny Myers, says, I was working in the background on Bill and Ted's. We got one shot to sell the producers of Family Matters on a robotic version of Steve Urkel. I mean, a robot Steve Urkel. I go, okay. He goes, dude, I'm going to bring you into Warner Brothers, I mean, to the people, Lorimar Studio, which is Warner Brothers. You got to really be on point. And if we come out of there with a job, you're getting paid. I go, say enough. I need the money. I went into that audition, and I tell you what. The producers are like, impress us. Because Family Matters was always a running show. They're like, how are you going to convince us to spend money on an episode, which is going to be expensive, and you make that episode hit? Our star is Jaleel White. but we want to see a robot version of Jaleel handle it. Telling you what, I said, okay, let me see a few episodes. They go, come back and impress us. I watched his episode. Did I do that, Steve Urkel? And I got his voice and his stance. Next thing I know, boom, I went in there, auditioned. They said, I got the job.
An unparalleled electronic achievement. The one, the only, Urkelbot.
Stop there. I did so well in the first episode. Part two was when I was with Lorabot. But guess what? Now we're talking going back to the streets. When they ask me, do you know anybody right now in your Rolodex or your numbers that could play the girl robot? You know who I called?
Who?
Bop and Ronnie. Now, Bop and Ronnie, robot Bop and Ronnie, Bop and Ron was a student of Dooney and Prince and all that. With his perm like Jesse Johnson. I called Bop and Ronnie and he was, you know, just hanging in the hood. I said, do you want a job? He goes, yes. I said, you got a job. When he came in, he's Lorabot. He got paid.
Out of all the people, what made you call Bop and Ronnie?
Because he was available and he had the robot style. Because think about it. I was small, 5'6", looking like Jaleel. Ronnie's really small and scrawny, so he could fit in the suit, but he had that robot, right? Yeah. It made sense, right? But back to giving back to the hood.
So he plays the girl.
Yes.
Ready to dance, Urkelbot? Let's get down with our bad sass.
Ronnie, you gotta come to Pop Lock Talk, man. Come talk to me about
that. So the thing is, paying it forward, people do this and like, what is shrimp dinner? Well, guess what? I'm speaking on it because through my years, when it was time for somebody else to be calling for a job, if they were available and I had the number, I just passed it and let God bless it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Bob and Ron had that job. Mm. He got that job. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And at the end, it was very meaningful.
Yeah.
Because guess what? They start hiring poppers in special effects.
Hey, man, tonight we mentioned Shabadoo's name a lot.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And every time we mention somebody's name as rest in peace, I give them 5 seconds of silence. Let's bow our heads, man. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Much love to Shabadoo. Man, how did it feel for you to lose that guy, man? Because you guys were close.
I'll be very, very honest. I was glad that him and I had come to a place of putting all of our childish, whatever was there, it was gone. Him and I had made peace. He had started studying the Bible. He had shared with me. His mom was a Jehovah's Witness. So the Jehovah's Witnesses had conventions at Long Beach at the time. And he said, Shrimp, I'm studying. I'm trying to repent. Can we put things beside us? And I told my family, I was like, I need to see this eye to eye because everybody does this. I want to see this man. I was so impressed because God had changed his life to the point where he was like making peace with everybody around him. We were able to do a few shows together. When he passed, I made sure when I got the call, Variety Magazine kind of governs world news. When they contact you and want your statement, it's a big deal. So I was glad right after that happened, Variety Magazine, not some blog or somebody's podcast, but where it was meaningful in the world, when they asked me, same thing you said, I was able to give his family and his kids dignity.
Mm.
Because that's all that mattered. Everybody else was doing all this, and it didn't care. Because Variety Magazine interviewed me.
So you guys came to peace with one another.
We came to peace, but how I felt was release that nobody, even after death, anybody that ever said, well, I think those two, this, guess what? The man paid his wages of sin, and for his surviving family members and his students and people, I never disrespected him. You know what? I never spited his name and his legacy.
Good.
Matter of fact, even better, right after Variety Magazine and all the Shabadoo stuff, well, it was all over the internet. Everybody's jumping on the same bandwagon. They didn't work with him, but yet they started attaching themselves to Ozone in the lockers, right? Guess what? Most beautiful thing that happened last year, his son and his managers said, Shrimp, can you do an honorable tribute to my father? I said, say no more, young brother.
Really?
That's your pops. We went to Memphis. We went to Memphis, Tennessee. They had a drive-in screening of Breaking 2. I did a Q&A with his son, Deshaun. That was the most beautiful send-off.
That's dope.
Just because I'm sitting there with his son.
His son.
How much better to get?
Yeah.
And guess what? Money couldn't put a price on what that
moment
did for his son.
Yeah.
Because all this went right out the door.
What was he like to you, man? Was he like a big brother or uncle? Or?
You know what? He was a mentor. And I'm going to be very honest. When somebody has a job and is paying bills, if you listen, they're going to teach you the skills to pay the bills.
Yeah.
So he taught me and everybody else how to go from the streets to the stage.
Mm-hmm.
Not being sedated or not being stuck up, but hey, if you're going to pay bills, you could hustle at a swap meet.
Yeah.
But if you work for FedEx or a corporation, you have to play corporate protocol and learn the ropes.
Mm-hmm.
So Shabadoo and Tony Bazzo, they were always divas because they were making the screen they were making Screen Actors Guild after money and equity.
Yeah.
When you're union, you can have that.
Mm.
If you're not union, you get checked by Britney.
Mm-hmm.
So look, she's like, shut up. So look. So the thing is, I was always that student. Okay, I'm gonna be good because I wanna go places.
Right.
And he knew, okay, just do and watch and keep your mouth shut and you'll be something. I'll tell you what. Look at my life. At 14 years old, everybody else that was doing it around the same age as me, look at how many jobs. Look at how many jobs that I was able to do.
Because
guess what? I did less this, and I did this. And I showed up on time, and I paid my taxes, and I paid my bills. So that's what Shabadoo and Tony Basil did. They went in the hood, and they said, okay, you know what? You got something there, but you got to know how to act. You gotta know when to be speak, like you showed me, when to speak and when not to speak. You gotta be on time. So they showed me the protocol.
You know, it feels good, man, to bury bullshit. Because most of the time, that's what it ends up being. But check this out. I'm not gonna just so much call it bullshit because, check this out. Us dancers, us are very passionate about our careers and what we do. And that's why the controversy and the arguments and the disagreements or whatever it is that may come up, because we're all passionate about what we... Me and you had a difference at one point.
But
and then But what did we do?
Resolve everything and keep it moving.
And I'm happy that we did, because look where we are today.
Exactly. Started from the bottom, now we're here.
Look what we accomplished.
But isn't that what grown men do?
That's what grown men do.
We teach the future if they want to learn. We're going to... Even the Bible says you're going to have disagreements, but you could be wrathful, but don't sin. And that's the difference between people in the streets. You could have a difference, but if you got a heart, if you got it in here, you're peaceful.
Well, love is everything.
It is. That's why you say pop, lock, love.
That's why I say pop, lock, love.
It's beyond the word. You have to show it, huh?
Right. Got to show it.
Seeing is believing, huh?
And we both showed it. You came here today and showed love.
It is what it is, right? And
I see us doing more from this point on.
Well, you know what? I look at it like this.
Because we buried some bullshit.
But beyond that, you and Brittany and this your establishment, God has blessed you with a vehicle to teach, to have work, and to help people. And if God blesses it, anything's possible.
God is very blessed,
man. You know what?
God blesses you, and you got to pay attention to the people he put around in your circle.
There you go.
Like, you name one person, you name Brittany. She's most definitely someone who has my back when it helps me running this business.
And we've all seen it.
And matter of fact, I want to give a shout out to a few others. There's another young lady by the name of Leslie. There's another young lady who her kid is here that helps out a lot. Christy, Savannah, man, shout out to all you guys that help out for this business. And because I need the help.
We all do, but we have to share that. I heard a saying, there's no man as an island. Behind every great man is a great woman or a great force. When we give to, you know, I have Olivia and other people, and I thank her for helping me be on point and do what I go. When we share that, well, guess what? Everybody's validated.
Yeah.
There's not one person that runs a show. So I'm glad that we're those kind of men, because guess what? At the end of the day, when everybody else is gone, they're going to be there for us. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Sure. What are you doing with the dance today?
For me, I'm going to be very honest. With the COVID and the way that the world is going, I take every day and am thankful whatever God gives me, because it was never me to do anything. It's God and whatever opportunity is there. And so for me, if dancing wasn't happening, I'll get a day job in a minute or do what I got to do. But with the COVID and everybody losing work or whatever, it's a blessing to even just do this. Look at it. Look.
That's why we said a prayer today.
No, but look.
And ask God for his blessings
before
we answer.
But I'm answering your question. Obviously, this is a start for doing something for the dance, because you created a battle that's been going on, and you asked me to be here. So I kind of feel, whether tomorrow's promise or not, we don't know. At least today, we did what we had to. You know what I'm saying? I mean, those people who left, they have memories. And anybody else that doesn't know about this battle, now the radar's on there, you know. And so I look at it like this. Tomorrow, we don't know what God's going to give us or what the next month is or next week. But today, we put it down. We put it down, dude. We put it down. All those people here that were videotaping and all those kids, they were the ones that seen, okay, you know what? I don't care what anybody said. They put it down, you know what I'm saying? So that's where I'm coming from. This is what we're doing. It's January. It's a new year. And we just started the year off.
So let me ask you this, man. When this COVID shit ends, hopefully it will soon, what are your goals from that point with this?
You know what?
What do you plan on getting into?
Right now, the way that the COVID's going, tomorrow's not promised. So I'm going to be real. I don't know what the next day or this is and that is. So when I wake up and my agenda, whatever comes on my daily grind, like you got your grind, I'm going to take it, because I could have these ambitions and these plans, but if something happens to me tomorrow or next week, it all went down the tube. So I learned to just take, and it's not AAA, it's like, you know what, one day at a time. I learned to take one day, because that may be all you got. So after today, I'm gonna ask God to give me more, whatever His will is, and just let it run its course, because there's this, there's that, but guess what? Many people have plans, and your plane ticket could be canceled or whatever. So I don't do this. I just wait to see what's gonna happen. But I'm not waiting back watching reruns of Good Times. I'm trying to grind each day, but I start my day off to make sure whatever God gives me, if it's there, I'm gonna put the work in. You know what I'm saying?
That's what's up.
It's very true.
That's what's up. That's what's up.
He's the one who writes my story, not me.
Okay. Brent.
Yes, sir.
I'm gonna ask you this again. Can we have some fun?
Yes, we can.
All right. Here we go. I want you to answer these questions. Your cupcake if you tap out.
Okay.
I need you to pick one. Snoop or Ice Cube?
Ice Cube.
Ooh, you got to tell me why you're choosing Ice Cube.
Well, I have to admit, Ice Cube did movies. He went from music to doing movies to hiring people.
Snoop did movies.
But Snoop did the Snoop plane, and he did some other things. But I mean, I'm being honest. When Ice Cube did the Friday movie,
he said the Snoop plane.
No. It's no disrespect. Yeah. Ice Cube, in my eyes, when he started employing people with movies, that out of those two, it was from your thing.
Okay, but when it comes to rap. Between them two?
That's a tough one because they both have different styles. Snoop is more smooth. Ice Cube's more, make it rain. Ice Cube's more aggressive. Ice Cube's got that Mac 10 kind of, hey, the gorillas. Yeah. Snoop is all, what you want to do for the shizzle, my nizzle? She's spouty.
Hey, Mike, who's the true MJ? Michael Jordan or Magic Johnson?
Gotta say, Magic Johnson.
Magic Johnson.
Because before Magic Johnson got the diagnosis with AIDS, nobody could touch his name. But the minute he had AIDS, it was like everybody else but Magic Johnson.
Oh,
but
man.
Magic Johnson didn't stop after the game. He had a Magic Johnson theaters. He started giving to people. He worked with his problem. Once they marked him for dark, he
kept inclining.
So it's got to be
nothing stopped this.
That's very true. Yeah, it's very true. It's very true.
A lowrider or a Lamborghini?
A lowrider. You know why? No. You know why?
Why?
Those guys who make lowriders, work with their hands. They can go to pick your part and shine up something with Bondo, and they know the paint and they know the all the little things to shine up that car.
Yeah.
Make it look better than a Lamborghini.
Ooh.
Because every time you look at a lowrider, you look at a Lamborghini, that's money and other people made the car. A lowrider was made by the homies from homies. So all the chrome, all the detail, even the artwork.
Okay.
That's an extension. That's like a rolling piece of art.
Okay.
It's very true. No, it's very true. That's a ghetto Lamborghini.
This is your answer. There is no right. But it's true. There is no wrong.
But it is true.
Okay. Here's a good one. Beyonce or Vanity?
Beyonce. You know why? She made more money. No.
That's why?
Think about it. Beyonce had cologne, blah, 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 hired dancers, kept doing stuff, da, da, da. Vanity looked good, and she did her thing, but guess what? After she broke up with Prince, no music, no nothing, and it's not taken away from her because I don't disrespect people who passed away. Vanity, at the time when she came out with Prince, she wasn't in Purple Rain. She wasn't in all that whole Minneapolis thing. But when Beyonce came out with Destiny's Child, she left Destiny's Child and became a mogul. Moguls create jobs and they keep the industry thriving.
Dope.
So it's very true.
Good answer, man.
It's the truth.
Good answer.
Oh, yeah.
B Street or Breaking?
Ugh, God. You ready?
Yeah.
I got to say Breaking. You know why?
Why?
I got to say it. You ready?
Mm-hmm.
Beach Street just showed New York, the subway, gazelles, and that. Breaking had New Wave. We had Japanese. If you look at Breaking, we got Jean-Claude Van Damme. Breaking represented the real world. When we go out in them streets, and if you live in a neighborhood, you got blacks, you got white, you got surfers, you got New Wave, you got everything. Beach Street, no, it's very true. We had every single thing. People went to school in a yearbook. I was wearing leg warmers. I was with the homies. You know, yes, we were. And you know this, man. No, the thing is, if you really think about it, yeah. We were really real. California people, you got every Beach Street was just one-sided. And that wasn't really what we were, how we were living. That's how New York was living. It's very true.
Okay, it's very true.
It is.
It's very true. That's your thing.
And we had the waves, dude. Oh, yeah.
Collard greens or tacos?
Oh, God, tacos. Because if you think about it, tacos have onions, tomatoes, guacamole. Wait, look.
Go ahead.
You could be a vegan.
Yeah.
Tortillas, corn tortillas, guacamole. Yeah. That's cilantro. Yeah. Tacos, if you dissect it, it has all these nutrients and vegetables all in one and a little bit of meat. I'm like this. Collard greens is just a vegetable. And if you watch Popeye, that's all it was. Popeye the Sailor Man. So tacos. It's true. It's true.
Who's your favorite cartoon character, man?
Oh, God. You know what?
What?
Look at the movie Breaking. And then I said, Breaking 2?
Yeah.
In the hospital scene. They said, okay, whoa. I'm going to answer it, but
okay,
with the movie.
Okay,
Woody Woodpecker. I used to live. Guess who? Yeah. I was like, oh, Woody Woodpecker and Donald Duck.
Donald Duck, okay.
Donald Duck and Woody Woodpecker. But I did Woody Woodpecker. They said, okay, what are you going to do when they open up the elevator? That was Woody Woodpecker. Yeah. But when Rick Dees did the song Disco Duck.
Yeah.
I really got to get wow. What are you having? The thing is, I Donald Duck. I love Donald Duck and Woody Woodpecker.
Okay. Very cool.
This one here gets this one here shrimp. This one here gets a lot of people on me. Muhammad Ali or Bruce Lee?
Oh God. Gotta say Muhammad Ali.
That's right.
You know why?
Why?
He didn't have to go to the floor. He didn't have to do anything but rope the dope. Poof. He still was the greatest.
He created
it's very true. Yeah. No. Matter of fact, it's on record. Bruce Lee learned Western boxing from Ali. No, it's very true. Well, Sugar Ray Robinson, all those. I mean, he studied boxing, and then they have Chinese boxing. But I heard somewhere that while Bruce Lee was going and learning Jeet Kune Do and all that stuff, he learned this, he learned that, but he also learned Western boxing. Yeah, yeah.
Shrimp. Jamaica. Or Hawaii?
Oh, God. No, wait. That's totally about. Oh, God. Hawaii. You know why?
Why?
They weren't smoking weed in Hawaii. They were just, if you look at Hawaii.
But what's wrong with smoking weed?
I didn't say anything.
I don't smoke either.
I didn't say anything.
Okay.
I didn't say anything about what's wrong with Hawaii. You asked me, Jamaica and Hawaii. My answer, in Hawaii, not only was it universal and everybody, but they didn't promote the ganja kind of thing. They were like, okay, look, local kamaaina, you could be cool, you could hang loose, and it was more of a cool calm, whereas from what I learned, people from Jamaica were like, okay, you know what? This is the Rasta life, and it wasn't really, it wasn't in comparison with me. Hawaii, it was more like, the sea breeze, the ocean, the goose, you know what I'm saying? That's what I meant. So Hawaii was more of a natural earth thing than just being under the influence.
Right.
It's very true.
Right. It's very true. Lakers or Clippers?
Oh, man. Lakers.
Lakers.
You know why? Because the Lakers really just put it down, man. I mean, for years, they played all these teams. The Clippers... everybody in LA holds their weight, but the Lakers is like an industry. It's like they made basketball something before the Clippers. Okay. It's true.
It's true. It's very true.
Extremely true.
Alright. Hennessy or gin?
Oh man. Well, I don't drink anymore. I haven't drank for a few years, but if I was to go back, I would have to say gin. You know why?
Oh.
No, because if you drank Hennessy, You might not remember where your keys were because this is too, the Hennessy will just take you to where you need to be and you'll go to sleep. Jen, where people are like, okay, excuse me, we're going to have party people. I mean, Jen was like something in Hollywood where people could have just a little bit, but not get too lit. But Hennessy was like, okay, you know what? My mind is playing tricks on me. I need to go to sleep because I think I saw Bonnie Raitt. Hennessy was like a dark drink.
Here's a good one, homie. Oh, and this Lord. Is going to be the last question.
Uh-oh, here we go.
Martin Luther King or Barack Obama?
Ooh. I got to say Barack Obama. You know why? Barack Obama, just as a person, non-political, when that man got out of his suit and started playing basketball, they were like, wait a minute. Why are you playing basketball? He goes, because that's what I do. I mean, other than the suit and all the rhetoric, whatever, I mean, on television, he really kind of just was kind of like Gavin Newsom and all these other people just walking around. I mean, I saw a picture of Gavin Newsom in East LA picking up trash by the railroad tracks. There was no suit. He was there with the homies. I was like, for me, that's like real. You could have a suit and tie thing, but when somebody gets dirty or whatever, I'm like, Barack Obama was like, okay, I'm going to play basketball because that's what I do.
Hey, man, that's it for my questions.
It is what it is.
I appreciate your time and consideration.
Yes.
I'd like to tell you, man, my award that I gave you tonight was sincere.
Oh, I know it was.
You know, you're a pioneer in this pop lock world, man, and hope we can continue to work together.
I appreciate it, but only if Brittany says we can come back. Got thrown in there. Right, that's on, man. All good. All right, now.
Hey, pop lock love to you.
It is what it is, man.
Well, yeah.
Thank you.
Much love.
Thank you for bringing for everybody together. Thanks again, Brittany.
Oh, hey, hey, before you leave, you got to throw me a wave, man. Throw
gotta
me a
do wave. It. It's a tradition.
Throw me a wave. Boom.
Boom. Booyah. See? He goes, booyah.
Booyah.
Booyah. What's pop locking, y'all? If you have not subscribed to Cool Boys Boxing Cap and Dance Academy, man, push that button. Come on. Push that button and subscribe. That way we may be able to send you an email and bring you on our show, Pop Lock Talk. This show, man, is, you know, to let everybody know that, you know, you got the rap industry, you got the hip-hop industry, you got the acting industry. Well, there's a such thing now as the pop lock industry. And this is where we talk about it right here. Cool Boys Boxing Cap and Dance Academy. Booyah!